So before the break, we spoke about how the real property tax cap has helped spur the economy in some cases, but how has it impacted schools? Well, schools would say not so well. The New York State Association of School Business Officials is out with a new report that shows that most schools have been diligent about spending to comply with the cap, but that does not mean all is well in the world of education vis-a-vis the tax cap. Michael Borges is the executive director of the Association of School Business Officials. He is joining me now in the studio to talk about their recommendations for the state. Welcome back to Capital Tonight.
Thank you for having me.
Okay, so this is analyzing property tax report card data for the school year of 15-16.
Correct,
right?
Yes.
So the current year that we're in
now. The coming year. No, it's for the coming year.
The coming year,
it's
sorry.
It's for the budgets that are going to be submitted to the voters on May 19th.
May 19th,
this
yep.
is the information that gets appended to the school budgets and also gets sent to the State Education Department.
Okay, so it does not include the Big Five.
Right. They're not required to file the property tax report cards because they're not independent school districts. They are part of their municipal governments. They're funded by the municipal governments.
Right, and that would be, of course, Buffalo, Rochester, Syracuse, Albany, Yonkers, New York City.
New York City.
Yep. So the interesting thing here is that your data shows that school spending will increase 1.9% and tax levies will increase 1.6% for the upcoming year.
Record lows.
That's amazing.
Yes.
I mean, really what we see is that districts, for all of their complaining, forgive me, about the tax cap, are really going to great lengths to stay under it.
Correct, yes. I mean, the 1.6 levy increase, the 1.9 spending increase, I mean, they are six-year record lows. So the tax cap is working in restraining school spending and restraining school levies. The tax cap is not successful in restraining school costs. Mm. We're having to move around expenditures and eliminate programs and sort of spend down our reserves, because that's another indicator is that in the report, in the property tax report card data, it shows that school district unreserved funding
right.
is at a low time low, a six-year low.
You know, though, the governor, and I know we've had this conversation before, would basically look at these numbers and say, success.
Success, yes. I mean, the tax cap is working in terms of the governor's position of restraining school spending and school levies, so yes.
Well, and it's also coming at a time when there was an historic increase in school aid by the state.
Yes, I mean, that between good school management in terms of allocating resources effectively, a record increase in school aid of the $1.4 billion or 6% increase, plus a significant drop in pension costs. Last year, pension contributions, employee contributions, employer contributions was 17%. This coming year for the 15-16 year is going to be around 13.26%. Mm. So there's a significant drop and a significant savings for school districts there. So between the increase in aid and the drop in pension expenses, that has also helped school districts manage their budgets.
But would your organization say it was a success? I mean, you have some recommendations based on the numbers that you ran and your report here. And, mandate relief, actually, I did discuss that. We're discussing that also on the show, and it's certainly no surprise. It's a continuation of an ongoing discussion.
Yeah.
But tax cap adjustments, I mean, if you're saying that the law should be adjusted, and I think your position would be to make it easier to override,
yes,
then you're not saying this is an unqualified success.
Well, it's a success from the governor's standpoint. It's not a success from school district standpoint.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, I want to qualify that statement. But yeah, I mean, the tax cap is working in terms of restraining spending. But again, it's not restraining the cost that's driving spending. That's all the whole thing about mandate relief. The tax cap also creates anomalies that, like the last 2-3 years in a row, we've had about a dozen school districts that have had negative levies because of the exclusions and the way the tax cap calculations work.
Yeah,
they've had proposed budgets that were actually less than the previous year, or levies less than the previous year because of these anomalies.
Levies being the amount that you raise through property taxes.
Exactly, right.
I mean, and just to be clear, we sort of shorthanded a lot, the 2% property tax cap, but it's actually a little bit more.
Yeah, each school district has its own cap
based
on its capital expenditures and pension costs and things like that. So the 2% is just a sort of easy way to explain it, but realistically, I think the voters are getting it finally, that each school district has its own cap, and it shows here that majority of school districts, once again, are staying within the cap.
Well, the proposal is to make the cap permanent. I mean, that's what people are pushing for, and you and others are, like, for example, the School Boards Association, others are saying, well, if you're going to make it permanent, you really should make some changes. Now, I don't know that there's going to be anything accomplished in the legislature, given sort of what's going on there. And it seems that APPR, which of course is the teacher evaluation system, and there's this summit being held today by SED, is sort of sucking all the air out of the room when it comes to the discussion on education. I mean, are you worried that this is going to get lost in the shuffle?
Unfortunately, I think it's easier for the legislature to give more money to address a problem than it is to fix the problem, which in this case is our unfunded mandates that are driving costs. You know, whether it's pension costs or healthcare costs or Tri-Borough Amendment, you know, labor costs, there are cost drivers that result in increased spending. And so if we can address those cost drivers, we can actually bring down levies even further and bring down spending even further.
Does your organization have a position on the APPR?
We've talked about that before on the show, and it's not an issue that our members are intricately involved in.
Mm-hmm. You didn't testify there.
No. Our position is that we need to allocate resources more effectively in schools. We get the funding that we do from both taxpayers and the state, and school business officials are in an ideal position, you know, using their expertise to allocate the resources that we do have to ensure that students get a sound basic education.
And we're going to run out of time soon, but I just want to also ask, do you have a mayoral control position? Because now we're talking about, or at least in Buffalo, sort of not replicating what's going on in New York City, but trying on the model of having all of this be answerable to one individual. I mean, would that make your job easier as a school business official?
I think that it's up to the individual communities. Whether it's a school board or it's a mayor or an appointed board, it's really up to the individual communities. And our association has no position on mayoral control.
But it could be easier if you had to go just to one individual instead of going to a board to try and.
Well, it depends on the community. Yeah. In some places where there's a lot of dysfunction, and I won't name that particular community, but it may work. In other places, it may not. So.
Right. We don't want to point fingers at anyone.
Yeah, it depends on the local circumstances.
Okay.
Yeah.
This is online if people want to see it.
Yes. It's been distributed. It's online. And, it's again, it points to record lows in terms of spending, levy increases, unrestricted savings that school districts have, because we've been spending down our savings to maintain our programs.
Yeah.
It also shows a continued decrease in student enrollment. The last 6 years, we've had lows in student enrollment, except for about one third of the school districts in the state, about 222, actually saw an increase in student enrollment, which is why we're calling for a return to growth aid, which is aid that's given to school districts in their current year to help offset the cost of
Those budget votes are right around the corner.
Yes.
And hopefully we'll have you back and you can tell us a little bit about how things fared.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael.